Hello, welcome to the self-learning podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on Unit 4, Change and Development in Rural Society. Indian society is primarily a rural society, though urbanization is growing. The majority of India's people live in rural areas, 67% according to 2001 census. They make their living from agriculture or related occupations. This means that the agricultural land is the most important productive resource for a great many Indians. Land is also the most important form of property, but land is not just a mean of production, nor just a form of property, nor is agriculture just a form of livelihood. It is also a way of life. Many of our cultural practices and patterns can be traced to our agrarian backgrounds. You will recall from the earlier chapters how closely interrelated structural and cultural changes are. For example, most of the New Year festivals in different regions of India, such as Pongal in Tamil Nadu, Bihu in Assam, Baisakhi in Punjab, and Ugadi in Karnataka, to name just a few, actually celebrate the main harvest season and herald the beginning of a new agricultural season. Find out about other harvest festivals. There is a close connection between agriculture and culture. The nature and practice of agriculture varies greatly across the different regions of the country. These variations are reflected in the different regional cultures. One can say that both the culture and social structure in rural India are closely bound up with agricultural and agrarian way of life. Agriculture is the single most important source of livelihood for the majority of the rural population. But the rural is not just agriculture. Many activities that support agriculture and village life are also sources of livelihood for people in rural India. For example, a large number of artisans such as potters, carpenters, weavers, ironsmiths, and goldsmiths are found in rural areas. They were once part and parcel of the village economy. Their numbers have been steadily lessening since the colonial period. You have already read in chapter 1 how the influx of manufactured goods replaced handmade products. Rural life also supported many other specialist and craftspersons as storytellers, astrologers, priests, water distributors, and oil pressers. The diversity of occupations in rural India was reflected in the caste system, which in most regions included specialist and service castes, such as washermen, porters, and goldsmiths. Some of these traditional occupations have declined, but increasing interconnection of the rural and urban economies have led to many diverse occupations. Many people living in rural areas are employed in or have livelihoods based in rural non-farming activities. For instance, there are rural residents employed in government services, such as the postal and education department, factory workers, or in army, who earn their living through non-agricultural activities. Now let us move to the next point, agrarian structure, caste and class in rural India. Agricultural land is the single most important resource and form of property in rural society. But it is not equally distributed among people living in a particular village or region, nor does everyone have access to land. In fact, the distribution of land holdings in most regions is highly unequal among the households. In some parts of India, the majority of rural households own at least some land, usually very small plots. In other areas, as much as 40 to 50% of families do not own any land at all. This means that they are dependent on agricultural labor or other kinds of work for their livelihoods. This, of course, means that a few families are well-to-do. The majority live just above or below the poverty line. In most regions of India, women are usually excluded from ownership of land because of the prevailing patrilineal kinship system and mode of inheritance. By law, women are supposed to have an equal share of family property. In reality, they only have limited rights and some access to land only as part of a household headed by a man. The term agrarian structure is often used to refer to the structure or distribution of land holdings. Because agricultural land is the most important productive resource in rural areas, access to land shapes the rural class structure. Access to land largely determines what role one plays in the process of agricultural production. Medium and large landowners are usually able to earn sufficient or even large incomes from cultivation, although this depends on agricultural price, which can fluctuate greatly, as well as other factors such as the monsoon. But agricultural laborers are more often than not paid below the statutory minimum wage and earn very little. Their incomes are low. Their employment is insecure. Most agricultural laborers are daily wage workers and do not have work for many days of the year. This is known as underemployment. Similarly, tenants, cultivators who lease their land from landowners have lower incomes than owner cultivators, because they have to pay a substantial rent to the land owner, often as much as 50 to 75% of the income from the crop. Agrarian society, therefore, can be understood in terms of its class structure. But we must also remember structure that it is through the caste system. In rural areas, there is a complex relationship between caste and class. This relationship is not always straightforward. We might expect that the higher caste have more land and higher incomes, and that there is a correspondence between the caste and class as one moves down the hierarchy. In many areas, this is broadly true, but not exactly. For instance, in most areas, the highest caste, the Brahmins, are not major landowners, and so they fall outside the agrarian structure, although they are a part of rural society. In most regions of India, the major landowning groups belong to the upper caste. In each region, there are usually just one or two major landowning castes, who are also numerically very important. Such groups were termed by the sociologist M.N. Srinivas as dominant caste. In each region, the dominant caste is the most powerful group economically and politically, and dominates local society. Examples of dominant landowning groups are the Jats and Rajputs of UP, the Vokaligas and the Lingayats in Karnataka, Kamas and Reddys in Andhra Pradesh, and Jat Sikh in Punjab. While dominant landowning groups are usually middle or higher ranked caste, most of the marginal farmers and landless belong to lower caste groups. In official classification, they belong to the stool caste or tribes or other backward classes. In many regions of India, the former untouchable or Dalit caste were not allowed to own land, and they provided most of the agricultural labor for the dominant landowning groups. This also created a labor force that allowed the landowners to cultivate the land intensively and get higher returns. The rough correspondence between the caste and class means that typically the upper and middle caste also had the best access to land and resources, and hence to power, the privilege. This had important implications for the rural economy and society. In most regions of the country, a proprietary caste group owns most of the resources and can command labor to work for them. Until recently, practices such as beggar or free labor were prevalent in many parts of the northern India. Members of low-ranked caste groups had to provide labor for a fixed number of days per year to the village zamindar or landlord. Similarly, lack of resources and dependence on the landed class for economic, social, and political support meant that many of the working poor were tied to landowners in hereditary labor relationships or bonded labor, such as Halpati system in Gujarat and the Jita system in Karnataka. Although such practices have been abolished legally, they continue to exist in many areas. In a village of northern Bihar, the majority of the landowners are Bhumidhar, who are also dominant caste. Now let us wind up the session. And thank you very much for engaging yourself with the self-learning podcast.